In their Christmas catalog for 1961, the American electronics vendor, Radio Shack, offered a unique tape recorder under its house brand name, Realistic. The machine was unique to the vendor because it was made by Robuk Electrical Industries of London, England. The two-track high-fidelity monophonic tape recorder featured a three-motor transport with three speeds, sound-on-sound, and sound-with-sound capability, housed in a stylish two-tone fabric-covered wood case. Radio Shack labeled it Realistic by Robuk, and it sold for a limited time. By 1963, it was gone. 54 years later, in 2016, a Realistic by Robuk tape recorder appeared on eBay. Recognizing the unique rarity and audiophile value of the machine, ClydeSight purchased it for historical preservation. Welcome to the Christmas Tape Recorder. This video series is a documentary of the arrival, exploration, and restoration of this rarely seen or heard unique consumer-grade tape recorder. I'm ready to begin restoring the tape recorder cosmetically, and I'm starting with the lid, and you see I'm wearing my bathrobe because I'm still recovering from my cold, but let's take a look at this lid and see what's going on here. It's in very good shape, but there is soiling here, and in the back here there is some marking which is soaked in. The piping seems to be in good shape, except at this point here, which we pointed out, I have an idea on how to fix that. Now, this has some brass accessory pieces here. This is for the clips that hold the lid down. And this one is for the hinge, the back hinge, which is a half hinge, so you can take the lid off. The little feet on this lid are fine. There's no reason to change them. So what I've done is I've gone to the other side and removed the clip and also the hinge. Now, something that's very important is when you remove something, make sure you pay attention to the way it went together. Now, this clip looks like it's just one piece, but it isn't. It's two pieces. So let's take a look and see why. Got them in this little tray here. And if you look here, this is the clip and here's the screw. See, there's a plate and then there's the catch. So the way it goes together is that the plate is aligned with the bottom and the curved part of the catch is up at the top. And that's the way they had it when I took it out. And of course, that's the way it looks here. So we're going to do an experiment with this brass. The tray that I have here has two compartments in it. See here, this is the right side hardware, which is on this side of the... And then the left side I'm going to take off and put it in the other compartment. And the reason for doing that is I have two different types of brass cleaners. And I want to see which one's more effective. Hang on, we'll have a little contest. I can't give you the product names because that would be offensive to the manufacturers. If you liked one over the other, you know, everybody wants to be the best and so on. So I'm just going to call them T and B. Now, B is the type of brass cleaner that comes as a liquid in a can. You pour it onto a cloth, wipe it onto the material that you want to clean, let it dry to film, and then you buff the daylights out of it. So this is what happened when I did the B method on one set of brass. The T cleaner is a water-based cleaner, and what you do is you take your brass and you wash it under hot water. And then you take the material that T provides with a special sponge they give you, and you rub it onto the brass and work it in, and then rinse the whole thing off and dry it, and you get this result. So I'm going to let you decide from what you can see what you think is better. Now, you got to remember that the lighting is reflecting. You see how that changes? So there is some reflection changing. To me, it's hard to decide which is better. I mean, both of them not dirt, but they leave marks behind. They both are chemical. They both smell like chemicals. But they do get most of the tarnish off, so that what I'm going to do with this now, I have a rotary tool with a buffing pad on it, and I'm just going to buff it with the buffing pad, and that'll be the end of it. Also to be note, whichever method you use for cleaning brass screws, that's a nightmare, because it's very hard to clean the screws. The best method I've ever found is to, believe it or not, put the screws into a drill chuck, and then spin the drill with some very, 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 very fine sandpaper held against the head of the screw, and that will polish it up nicely. Now, once all of this is done, it's going to all discolor again, unless you put a coat of clear coat on the brass. So that's what I'm going to be doing. My idea of cleaning the brass fittings for the lid and the side of the tape recorder, the hinges and so on, had a serious flaw in it, which I didn't discover until I looked at it very closely. Some of these brass fittings aren't really brass, they're coated. And all of the fittings had a coating on them, so when I was cleaning them with the brass cleaner, I was just cleaning the coating. And it turned out that some of the screws were actually silver underneath that coating, so once that got cleaned off, so did the brass coloring. And this is a material which I believe it's called Rexine, R-E-X-I-N-E. I've been watching some videos on YouTube about Dansett phonographs, which were very, very popular in England at the time. Beautiful machines. And there are a lot of people who do some very wonderful restorations, and they talk about Rexine as a covering. And there was a similar product used in the United States for Webcore and other tape record players, not tape recorders. Webcore made tape recorders out of using different plastics and things. But anyway, I think that this may be Rexine. I don't know. While I was doing a search for information about this particular tape recorder, I discovered an online copy of the user manual, and there was a little area in the user manual where it said to clean the case, just use standard soap and water. So what I did was I wiped this down with a sponge using dishwashing detergent, because that's a gentle soap and it also helps get rid of grease. And it seems to have cleaned it up quite nicely. This looks much better to me now than it has. If you look at it, it may sometimes have some yellow coloring, but that's the camera. That's not what I'm actually seeing. But the red seems to be very nice, and it appears to be very clean now. And here we can see the where I did the brass, and you can see that the screws are actually a little silverized. Here is the hinge in the back, and so you know we learn the hard way sometimes. Now the only thing left on this to deal with is this gap here. And I have an idea on how to fix that. I went online and I got some of this material, which is tub and tile, seal and bond, and it comes in an almond color. And it's basically silicone. And so what I'm going to try and do is put a little bead of silicone right in this gap. And to do that, I'm going to have to tape off the sides and then put the silicone in. So I'll do that, let it dry, and then show you what it looks like. I completed the patch to the piping on the lid. The patch is right here. So I filled the gap with the silicone and had a little bit extra hanging out. And then I took a piece of white Romex cable and just took the shielding off the cable. So you know, basically taking the insulation out, and cut the insulation to the size needed and pressed it in. It's not an exact match, but it's certainly close enough. The fact that it looks like a patch would probably just simply demonstrate that this has been cared for. And it should hold on because it's silicone bonded to the inside of the groove that this is all riding in. So I'm going to call this a done deal and move on to the bottom of the case. The lower part of the case is all cleaned up and ready to go back into service once a few other things are done to it. I cleaned up pretty nicely. This wonderful, I'm calling it Rexine. I don't know if it's Rexine. It may be, a vinyl, just a vinyl cloth. But it didn't have any trouble with color fading, and it cleaned up really, really nicely. So we see here from the front how the handle polished up very nicely. And this is all cleaned up, and the staining is all taken out of here. It just simply responded very well to the detergent. And on the side here, we can see here is the clip, which I polished up. And here is the opening for the volume and input-output controls. Here we have the back, all nicely cleaned up. And the back door now has a knob, so it can slide open and closed very nicely. And the hinges are polished. And then the other side, of course, same thing, where it's all polished and cleaned. And I didn't try to take any of the dents out of the metal on this side, or it was especially here, there's a dent on here, right here. It's just a... it's a badge of courage, shall we say, a badge of honor. The biggest issue that this has is when we look at the bottom of the case. And most of the staining came out from the bottom, but there was a lot of damage to the two grills that we noticed that before. And this is actually scratched up, so this is damaged, so it's not going to clean up. One of the other things I did was I replaced the feet here, because we only had three of the original feet, and the fourth one was the grommet or something. So I got some white rubber feet from eBay and put it on, and they look very nice. The other thing that we need to deal with is the speaker grill. And these are the two issues that are most important to dealing with cleaning up this case. Now, the speaker grill we knew had problems. We looked at it before, and you can see all of this staining. Now, this took place, I believe, because I think that it's made of this fiberboard, and I think that the dye on the fiberboard leached into the cloth. This is never going to come out. So I have a solution for that that I'm going to try, which involves some white cotton and some plastic grill. And the plastic grill, the reason I'm using the plastic grill is because I have to use it for the next part of the restoration, which is the vents. Now, I'm showing you this side. This is the inside of the vent, and this one has damage because you see it has these posts here to hold it into the case, and there are clips that hold them. But the posts had been broken on this one, so but they were in the case, so I got them out. But they're going to have to be put back. And if you look at this side, I've wrapped duct tape, the handyman's friend, all around the edges, because what I need to do, the edges of all this plastic is so brittle and old, the edges have cracked and broken. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to paint epoxy all in here, clear epoxy, to strengthen it and to give it solidarity. And then what I want to do is I want to cut out this old grill. And after I cut out the old grill, I'm going to replace it with a new grill. Now, this is called plastic canvas, and it's available on eBay. And the squares, they measure it by the number of squares per inch. This is, I believe, 7 squares per inch. You can get 10 squares per inch, which makes it tighter, or 5 squares per inch, which makes it bigger. I went with this because it seemed pretty close to what was already here. So the idea is that when this is all epoxied, I'll cut the old grill out, and then I'll put this new grill on top of it, epoxy it down, and then cut it, and it should look like a new grill. The alternative would be just to take this material and just attach it to the bottom. But that's not keeping in with the spirit of the tape recorder, although it would it'd be much faster and quicker, but it wouldn't keep the appearance of the tape recorder that they had with this these two cutouts. So I want to try to do the other thing that I described. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, I have another sheet of this, so I could go with the route of just applying that. I mean, the purpose of it is to vent the tape recorder. Now, that also is going to work with this, because when the cotton is, white cotton is there, I can put this right over it, and it forms a nice grill for the speaker, and it won't look all dirty or messy. And so that's going to be the next part of the project for restoring this. Another part from the inside of the case is this curious-looking pouch. And what this is the pouch that held the accessories. It was originally back here, and it was held in with staples. I took it out, removed the staples, and I put screws in there, and I've got screws. They're just here, so I know where to put them when I put them back. And so that's how this was held in. Now, what's fun about this is it gives us some information about the tape recorder. I'm not sure if you can read this. I'll hold it up to the camera. But it says Robuk Electrical Industries, and it says model number RK3B. Not sure if you can see that. Let's see if I can focus it on that. So it's RK3B. The label tells us that it's 110 volts AC only, and that it's going to use, believe it or not, 200 watts at 2 amperes. So it's a pretty it's a pretty hefty tape recorder. So that is what belongs there. And then finally, to show you, here is the plate for the controls. And you can see this did have a fading problem. See, they made it, it's this plastic, and they coated it on this side, but it discolored on this side, and here's the print and everything. And there's really nothing I can do about that, so I'll just clean it up, but it's not going to be restored to the original color. So you see how it's faded compared to the color of the case. I'm ready to redo the speaker baffle, and we see the components here. Here's the speaker. I want to be careful of that because it could be damaged while I'm manipulating things, so be very careful of that. This is the baffle. This is the new grid that I created, and this is the original cloth. So let's take a look at the original cloth first. You can see it's so badly stained. That's never going to come out. I mean, even though I got it off the baffle, that staining is through the cloth. It's permanent. It's part of the fiber now. So this is pretty much shot. But notice the grid pattern of the cloth. That's what I'm going for. I want to do as much as I can to emulate that. I can't emulate the, if you look on the edge here, not clear how clear that is, but there's little red stripes sewn in with the white, and that gives it that red-white checkerboard effect, which is very nice, but it's not going to happen. So what I have is this replacement material, which is a plastic grill material, and very, very flexible, very, very tough, and it's that stuff that they called canvas, plastic canvas. Now, obviously, the grid size is different, but I want to match the grid size for what I'm using on the bottom of the tape recorder, so I have some level of consistency. And I punched holes for the screws, so that's ready to go. Now, the baffle, as you can see, this is the actual baffle. And the other side of it, I sanded it. And then I glued this cotton fabric onto it. And it's very stretchy fabric. You see how I can push my finger right through it. I'll let you guess where it came from. But when this is placed together, it's very solid because of the plastic, And this forms a nice backing for the plastic because the plastic is so flexible. And then the speaker, of course, goes there. And so now it looks pretty solid. So I'm happy with this solution. I could have just done this, the speaker with the grill, but you see how dark that is by comparison? And the other thing I'm thinking is I want to keep the tape recorder as original as possible. And in order to do that, I need to keep all the original parts if I can. So it doesn't hurt anything to add this little bit in the front. In fact, it helps preserve it. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to put it in the case now, and then we'll take a look at it. So the first thing that goes in is the plastic baffle, and that fits onto the posts. Then the cloth wood fiberboard baffle. Just has to be kind of pushed down through the cloth. The cloth was split to be open for it. And then finally the speaker. And this is the one that, this is the part that has to be very carefully done. I don't want to put the post through the speaker paper. Now this can slide back and forth, so I'm just going to loosely put it in for now. And then when I put the tape recorder back together, I can finalize the exact locations side to side that it needs to go at. So let me take care of that. And now we can see the completed restoration. And I can still feel the grid, but I can't push in, and I couldn't hurt the speaker even if there was an accident because the baffle is protecting it. And I think it looks pretty nice. Nice cream color, which goes with the cream color here. So I'm calling this a done deal. Now for the bottom parts. I've rebuilt the venting grids for the bottom of the tape recorder case. You can see the tape recorder over there, and they're ready to go in. I wanted to show you this in detail. I'm not terribly proud of the work that I did because it didn't come out as well as I wanted it to, but I wanted to show you what I was up against. Originally, this frame that you see that I'm holding had this grid as part of it. But this grid was not, this is the most solid piece I've got out of it. It's cracked and broken as we saw earlier. Now, not only that, but also you can see here the frame broken, 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 and up here it's also broken. Right there. So with all that breakage, I thought what I would do is I was holding it together with the duct tape on the other side, and I painted it with epoxy. But for some strange reason, the epoxy wouldn't hold. It wouldn't dry. That was the problem. And I've worked with epoxy for years, so it wasn't my mixing, I don't think. I'm wondering if the epoxy had some kind of an argument with the plastic. So I gave it a week to dry, and it finally did dry after a week. It was a little bit tacky still, but we had to move on. So I used something that's called plastic canvas, and this is 7 on center, which means 7 grids, 7 squares to the inch. Comes in 5, 7, 10, and 14 squares to the inch. It's only the 7 squares to the inch that comes in multiple colors. And this is an ivory which I had bought, hoping it would closely match the color of the frame. I didn't think I could find anything that would match the color of the grids. And not only that, but I couldn't match the grid either. So I cut the material out. It's very easy to cut. It's very flexible. And laid it on the frame with another type of adhesive, which is Loctite. It's like the what you use to decorate cakes. You squeeze it. It's very hard to squeeze because it's very thick. But what I did was I made a bead all the way around the inside of the frame here, pressed the material down, the grid material, and then pressed it into the tape recorder on top of wax paper, put some weights on it to try and hold it together. It's holding, but not by much. So that's not a happy solution. But the way it's done is that it overlaps the frame so that when these pins are locked down, the frame helps hold it in place. This second grid wasn't quite as bad as the other grid. Now, how does this go into the tape recorder? Well, we're going to see that now. Here we have the tape recorder bottom, and the grid goes this way for that one, and this way for that one. And they just simply, it goes into the holes here, these posts, so I carefully align it. Takes a second. Then I can press it down. Do the same here. I want to be very careful with it and then just press it. The bottom of the tape recorder is quite flexible because it's made of that fiberboard, and this is flexible also. I could try and use some kind of a plastic to cloth glue, but then you'd never be able to get them out again. So that is what they're going to look like when they're locked down. Now, how do they lock down? Well, that's actually quite simple. And what's helpful is if you notice that the table is not as wide as the feet. The table will support this so the frame won't crack when I try and push these little pins. These are the retaining clips, and they slide on the pin like this. And then that locks it in place. So I'm going to go ahead and do the rest of these now. Here are the grids in place, and they're locked down, and they're as tight as they're going to get. If you look from the side, see a little bit of an edge, and that's caused by the grid being underneath the frame here. And here are the clips holding it in, both of them. The next thing we need to put in is the box that holds the accessories, which is here. Now, I've got this rubber bumper here, and that is for the speaker because the box goes up against the speaker and we don't want it to vibrate. And it's held down with two screws here and here, so I'll put that in now. The box is in place. Here's the screw and the other screw holding it in. And it's tight on this end, and the speaker can move. And it's a little hard to see, but if you take a look right now, you could see the little rubber piece. See that the brown rubber piece right up against the edge of the speaker cone, not the cone itself, the frame. And so I'm just going to move the speaker to help hold this in, because what the speaker does is keeps this end from flipping out. The speaker is now in place. You can see it's beginning to get tight, especially here, when you have the grid in and the box in. So that's why the components had to come apart and then be put back together. I like the way the plastic looks, the grid material itself. And here we see it from the underside. I'm not terribly thrilled with the job I did, but I had to do it this way. It was the only way I could get it to assemble, because this material would never have glued directly to the plastic on an edge, so it had to be, you know, sandwiched. And I did the best I could with it. I'm a little embarrassed about that, but anyway, I'm arguing for my limitations, so I'll shut up. Now, the last piece was this, and this is the little handle for the sliding door for the compartment. Now, I've seen some pictures on the internet of these tape recorders, and this is actually a red piece, this shape, but I don't have anything red. This is a white, it's a bushing that came with a shelving set, and I didn't use the bushing and saved it with my parts bin. You know, I'm sure that you do the same thing. Anybody who tinkers with stuff learns anytime you get any kind of parts, if you're not using them, put them in a jar, save them, because you never know when they will come in handy. So this worked out perfectly for this handle here. So now that the handle is in place and the little box is in place, all the storage can take place. And when the lid is placed on it, we now have a completed tape recorder case. This is the grill for the speaker, and you can see how it matches, obviously, the grill for the ventilation, and then there's the hole there for your hand. That's actually for the controls, which we will see eventually. So, this is all working out very well, and there is something to put in the compartment, and that is the little microphone, which I have all the components for right here. Now the microphone had all these bumpy edges on it. Which I smoothed out using the rotary tool. And when I took out the element, which I'm not sure if it's crystal or dynamic, there was all this foam inside here which had rotted. So I have a nice piece of foam here for it to rest against, and I will be putting that back together. But that is for the next video. So thank you for watching the video on the realistic Robuk tape recorder cosmetics. We will get into the machine in the next video and find out what we need to do to bring it back up to speed electronically and mechanically. Thanks for watching the video. Please remember to like and comment on the video so that we encourage YouTube to make it available to other people. Bye-bye.